Well, I think we have pretty well just about everybody's here. So I think with your permission, I would like to go ahead and get started. That okay with everybody? Give me a thumbs up if you're ready. Okay, that sounds like a good plan. Well, good morning and welcome. It's wonderful to see new faces, to see familiar faces, to see all kinds of people on this call today. And I think everybody's able to hear me. We've said hello, we've had some good chats already this morning. I guess I could ask the question, if you can't hear me, let me know. But if you can't hear me, how would you let me know? Okay. So I'm really excited about Michael's presentation, Is Your Money at Risk? It's such an interesting time in the market and in the world. And as you know, I get up in the morning and I check my accounts and I'm like, holy smokes, you know, it's just kind of an interesting time. So Michael is here to really share a lot of information with us. I know I can't wait to hear what he has to say. Before we begin, as some of our standard housekeeping, I want to make sure that you know that you'll be muted during this so we don't get background noise. But if you have a question, you can raise your hand. I know Michael likes to keep these conversations kind of informal and more conversational. So if something pops in your head that you want to ask him, just go ahead and wave your hand or give us some signs so that Joyce can unmute you so that you can ask the questions right at that time. And we do encourage you to ask those questions because that often inspires a line of conversation that keeps us all informed. We like these to be interactive and informative. Okay, so let's see. All right, Joyce, how do I go to the next one? Sorry, Joyce is going to help me for a minute. Okay, there we go. Okay. You would think as many times as we've done this, I would get this, but I'm a slow learner when it comes to technology. Okay, Mr. Michael Barnes, we have a trusted expert with us today and clearly a leader in his field. I've known Michael for quite some time and he's passionate about his work. He cares about the people he works with and works for. He's creative in his wealth management and in his relationship management. So Michael Barnes is the Vice President of Wealth Management for FineMark National Bank and Trust. Michael will discuss the six pillars to consider to protect your wealth and make your money safer. I'm excited to hear this. He will also share his observations and insights from his 20 plus years helping clients navigate wealth planning obstacles. Michael is a member of the Sun Health Foundation Board of Trustees, and he serves as chairman of the Council of Professional Advisors for Sun Health. So with that, Michael, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you, and I will mute myself so you can take it away from here.
Fantastic. Thank you, Gina, for that introduction and the invite. I mean, this is special being on with all you, Gina and friends, or Coffee with Gina and Friends. This is fantastic. I got to tell you, though, I do feel a little pressure having to follow Dr. Musa, the last presentation you had. That was really, really good. And then, of course, right behind me, the great David Eastman, which he's a fantastic estate planning attorney. But again, thank you for the invitation, and I appreciate spending the next hour with you all. It has been quite a year, obviously. We've experienced quite a bit, and we're still working through some things, but we're almost at the end of 2021, which is just amazing to think about. But as we approach the holidays and December right around the corner, right now is a great time to just step back and kind of reflect on our wealth plan and make sure we've got things buttoned up and we're protected. So I've put together, as Gina said, 20 years now in the industry, kind of grew up in the trust and estate world. I do head the Arizona Trust and Estate Group for FineMark National Bank and Trust. And I've had quite a few experiences and situations with clients through the years. And I think from that, I wanted to share with you all what I believe are some pillars, I would call six pillars that we all should consider as far as protecting our wealth and our family going forward. So I've put together a little presentation here, which I'm going to share my screen with you all. Make sure it works. There, are you all able to see that? Thumbs up. Yep, good. Okay. So again, wanted to kind of go over six what I call six pillars. And a lot of this is common sense, but we tend to in life, like anything, gets busy and we tend to forget things or we just kind of put it away and shelve it for a little while. As far as these six pillars, I just want to preference that, you know, we're all different. Obviously, our situations are different, and we do have our advisors, attorneys, and accountants, and investment advisors, and bankers. And it's very important that each of you do meet with those folks to make sure that your particular plan is in place and then things are buttoned up. But as far as the six pillars, some of the things that we should be considering that I want to go over today: account type, asset types, and titling are important. As far as ownership structure, obviously each account is handled differently depending on the type of account it is. Life and estate planning, we'll get into some things that you should be considering, and maybe some things that you haven't thought about. Insurance, although I'm not an insurance agent, but working with clients, I do see this every day, and there are a few things that I wanted to bring to light as far as insurance and things we should consider. And then, you know, the market's been treating us well the last few years. We've had a little bumpy road here and there, but over that period of time, we've seen a pretty nice trajectory. So investment management and budgeting is a part of that, those pillars. ID protection, I mean, I know Gina mentioned that you'll have your IT gentleman in next session or two. I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail, but there are some things, again, that I've experienced that I want to bring to light that I think we should all be wary of and put in place to protect ourselves. And then health is another piece of it, health and wealth. I think that's very important. We don't think about that, but that is an important piece to the overall wealth plan. And I'll go into some detail on that and some things to consider. So going into the first pillar, asset type and titling, obvious thing, we all should be continuing to take inventory of our assets. We want to understand the assets that we own, the type of assets that we have, again, different types of accounts, different types of assets, the ownership structure of those assets. They can be handled differently, not only during our lifetime, but if we're unable to take care of ourselves, or upon our passing, certain types of accounts or titling of assets get handled different ways. So I want to go over that. And if we're not careful, we can be susceptible to some risk of that, of those accounts and those assets. I do get a lot of questions over on FDIC and SIP insurance. So I do want to touch a little bit on that as well and provide some clarification. I think some folks get a little hung up on what's truly covered and how that works. So we'll cover that as well. So as we take inventory of our accounts, there are different types of accounts. There's taxable accounts. You know, we've got our bank relationships, checking, savings, money market, certificate of deposits. We may have investment accounts in our name, or perhaps in a trust name or joint name. Those taxable accounts, we need to understand how those are set up. Other types of assets on our taxable side, real estate would be one. Personal tangible property could be another one that would fall into that group. On the other side, we've got tax deferred and non-taxable accounts. So many of us may have traditional IRAs or Roth IRAs, pensions, life insurance, and annuity goes into that as well. And I would also say on the taxable account, you know, not all of us have just traditional FDIC bank accounts. Some of us may have credit union relationships. So those would follow in there as well. So just understanding what makes up your overall wealth portfolio and what's in what bucket. And that's an important thing, because we do have, we do make transitions in life sometimes, and things do change throughout the year. Account titling. That's very important when it comes to the type of accounts that you have and how those are set up. You know, the ownership, obviously, who owns that would be in control of that. But there may, with that, we could be susceptible to liability or creditor risk. Some of the more common ones with let's just take checking accounts or even investment accounts, individual titling. Obviously, one person owns that entity. We see a lot of joint tenants of rider survivorship, husband and wife, but also could be a child. We see that quite a bit, where a child may be on the account, or a number of children to help oversee that relationship. Other types of ownership, tenants in common. Don't see that quite often, but there is that once in a while. The account is owned by multiple holders. They can each own a different percentage of that account, but they do have control over that percentage, and they can bequeath that to whomever they want. And then there's other ways that you can structure your account, payable on death or transfer on death. We do see that quite a bit, where you may be an individual owner, and then you may name your children or a charity as the beneficiary on that. And then there's other types. I mentioned some folks name their or title their account in the name of their trust. It could be a revocable trust. It could be an irrevocable trust. We'll kind of talk a little bit more about that in a moment, as well as business relationships and accounts. So one question I get a lot is on the FDIC and SIP insurance. And I see folks quite a bit, often they're very concerned with FDIC coverage. They want to make sure all their bank relationships, all that's all covered under there. So they may have multiple bank accounts, multiple bank relationships. The downside of that is just the nuance of tracking everything. You may have multiple statements, or I've seen in some cases folks had create an account a long time ago and kind of just left it dormant and forgot all about it. They may have a CD that just keeps turning over and they keep forgetting about that particular asset. But FDIC coverage. So FDIC coverage protects you against loss of insured deposits if an FDIC insured bank fails. So the FDIC was created in 1933 as a result of the experience of the 20s and 30s with the bank failures at that point in time. So it is a government agency. And the way it's structured, it covers up to $250,000 per depositor, per FDIC insured bank, and per ownership category. So per ownership category can be, as I mentioned earlier, individual account. It could be a joint tenant with right of survivorship would be another category. An individual ownership with payable upon death would be another category. So there are some nuances to how FDIC covers your various accounts if you're in different types of ownership category. And I'll give some examples here in a moment. The types of accounts that are covered, checking, savings, money market accounts, CDs, certain types of retirement accounts. You may have a deposit account and even an IRA that would also be covered if under FDIC insurance. On the other side, some of us may have a traditional brokerage relationship, and you may have heard of SIPC. That's the Securities Investor Protection Corporation. So SIPC was created in 1970, so it'd be 51 years now, and that was a result of really kind of the 60s, when a lot of folks were getting into stocks and bond trading, and a lot of these brokerage firms just didn't have the capacity to track clients' holdings, and they were commingled within a lot of these brokerage firms. And SIPC coverage is really there to cover if a brokerage firm fails, if it becomes financially troubled. So it protects up to $500,000 for those brokerages that are members of the SIPC from loss of cash and securities. But I want to be clear that it doesn't protect you from a loss of value. So if you bought a stock, Microsoft, and it went down in value, it doesn't protect you from the decline in the value. Or if there was some investment suggestion from your advisor that you went into and it didn't really work out, doesn't protect you from that. It truly protects if a firm fails and is liquidated. So it protects up to $500,000, which includes up to $250,000 in cash. Since 1970, it seldom has been used. A lot of times, if a firm is to fails and it's to be liquidated, usually another firm will purchase those relationships, and then those custody of those accounts would slide over. So again, SIPC, it's not the same as for the cash protection that FDIC gives you at insured institutions. So that's, and then one other thing I would mention, credit unions. Credit unions, they're not under the FDIC insurance, but they do have their own insurance product. And I think it's called NCUA, I believe it is. And it's similar to FDIC, where it insures up to $250,000 of your assets there. So just a couple examples, some scenarios, and anyone can do this. The FDIC has a website, fdic.gov, and there's an actual calculator on that website where you can actually enter your account relationships. It asks for the titling, the ownership structure, the name of the bank, and then the amount, the value of that account. So it'll actually calculate for you what is insured and what is uninsured. And it does change. So it's good to periodically review this. And if you have got a good bank relationship, perhaps sitting down with your banker and going over this with your particular relationship. So in this case, we've got a mother who has a joint account. She's named her son as a joint owner, and the value around $220,000, but she also has a second account in her name only. And she's put on there a payable upon death designation to both of her children, Peter and Sally, and that's around $600,000. So based on the FDIC coverage at this one single bank, the joint accounts are fully insured. Both Mary and Peter have each up to $250,000 coverage, so it's well under those thresholds, and it covers that. The payable upon death account, however, the way FDIC looks at that, they're looking at the payable upon death beneficiaries, and the amount of beneficiaries you have are the ones that receive the coverage of $250,000. So in this case, the balance of $600,000, the account is insured up to $500,000. Peter has $250,000 and Sally has $250,000. It does not look at Mary as the owner of the account.
Hey, Michael, could I ask a quick question as it relates to that scenario where Mary has an individual checking account payable on death to Peter and Sally? Is there a time frame upon her passing? Does that get frozen, or do Peter and Sally have access to that immediately?
Oh, yeah, great question, Gina. So as joint owners, the ownership structure is they're both full owners of it. So they have full capability to deposit and withdraw. So let's say Mary passes away. Peter, as the joint owner, now owns that account 100%. Does that answer your question? So that individual would then be the owner. You could have multiple owners. If Mary had put Sally on there with Peter as joint owners, then if she passed, both Peter and Sally would then step up and own 50% together of that account.
So I think maybe the message here is to make sure if Peter and Sally are brother and sister, sometimes you want to make sure they get along.
Yes, absolutely. I've got a couple more stories that I'm going to share with everyone so we can talk into that. But yes, great, great point, Gina. It is important. And that's why it goes back to what I said earlier, the ownership structure. When you look at the whole, whatever under your wealth umbrella, you want to make sure that those accounts are titled appropriately to kind of carry out what your wishes and objectives are. Because if you forget one little step, or maybe you missed someone in the whole plan, it could be skewed. And we'll talk a little bit about that.
And Michael, these are not under a trust. These are
correct. Correct. Right. So the second example is under a trust. So in this case, it's one category according to FDIC. It's the revocable living trust that Mary has set up. And she has both a checking account and savings account at one institution. And it's totaling around a little over 1.1 million. The FDIC, there's different types of ways they look at accounts named in a trust. There's the formal revocable living trust and informal. Informal would be something like if Mary had it in her name only and she did a payable upon death to her living trust. That would be more of an informal setup. A formal would be Mary has the actual trust document that she's created and she goes to the bank and she establishes a bank account in the name of the trust and provides a copy of that, designating her as the trustee and then whomever her beneficiaries are. So this is a formal revocable living trust account. In this case, again, FDIC does not look to Mary as the, she's the owner, but she's also the trustee. So the trustee or whomever is named as successor trustee is not calculated in the FDIC coverage. So in this case, it looks to the number of beneficiaries. So she has two beneficiaries, both Peter and Sally. They each received $250,000 in FDIC coverage. So the insured part is $500,000, which leaves the remaining amount uninsured. Now, if Mary named a charity in there as well, or other beneficiaries, that would bring that insurance up to another $250,000 per beneficiary. So if she had five beneficiaries, she would have full coverage of that. So that is something that to be cognizant of. A lot of folks get a little hung up on that. It does get confusing, and the FDIC does have quite a bit of a lot of different nuances depending on, you know, is the beneficiary a true primary beneficiary or are they just a contingent beneficiary? A lot of that dictates the actual coverage. So it is good to sit down with your banker. If you do have an account titled the name of your trust, make sure that you've got the full coverage and they can help you through that as well. So a little scenario here. This is something to kind of think about. And it kind of goes back to what your question was, Gina, regarding the joint ownership and how that's taken care of. In this case, you know, we've got a mom. She has two adult children. Her husband had passed a few years back. And she has one son that's local and her daughter lives out of state. And her son is in the medical profession. And she's named her son as a joint owner of her bank accounts, as well as her investment account. She does have a smaller IRA that her husband was named beneficiary of, and she has not updated that. There's no contingent beneficiary. So kind of want to talk through two scenarios. One, during her life, while mom's living, you know, where are we susceptible here? Where could the risk be? And then of course, upon her passing, how do things kind of shake out? So as the joint owner with her son of the checking account, we've got a bank A and bank B. We're well under the $250,000 each. So we're fully covered in FDIC insurance. So there's no concern with the insurance coverage. But as we talked, Gina, your question, the son being the joint owner, he has full access to that account. So there's no... nothing dictates that the other owner has to approve or authorize if the other owner goes in and withdraws cash. I mean, they've got both have equal rights. So all the cash could be withdrawn. They can make deposits into the account. It's a joint ownership. Same with the brokerage account. It's in joint name. The son is a half owner of that brokerage account as well. But one thing I'd point out, you know, we unfortunately live in a very litigious society here in the U.S. and the son being in the medical profession, high liability profession, there is some creditor risk there with these joint account ownerships, where if the it is mom's assets, but she's now named the son joint owner. So he is now part owner of that. If someone were to come forward and, you know, sue him or he had some creditor issues, those creditors could tie on to those accounts. There is a good chance that those could be susceptible to creditor risk. So that is something to think about as far as the liability side of things. As far as the passing, when mom passes away, the son will become the full owner of both the checking accounts and the investment account. That just slides right over, and now he is 100% owner. The daughter would not be authorized to control any of those accounts. So again, it goes back, as Gina said, the relationship between your children or whomever's in that ownership role. You want to be sure that there's a good understanding that, you know, things are going to be fair. If that's what your wishes are, that'll be equalized. You're kind of at the mercy of the owner now carrying those wishes out. The IRA, when mom passes away, the husband was the named beneficiary, the husband predeceased mother. There's no other named beneficiary. So that asset will actually pass through her estate through probate. And it'll eventually get out to both the kids per her will, because she leaves everything equally. But the checking account, the brokerage account would not go through probate, because now the son is the 100% owner. The IRA would, because there's no named beneficiary of that particular asset, and therefore it will have to go through the probate process. So again, it's important in this scenario, mom wants to make sure everything gets equally to the children, and hopefully it does happen. But you know, some things can take place, some other direction can happen. So you want to make sure everything's buttoned up in that scenario.
Hey, Michael, this brings to my mind, and maybe you're going to get into this, so I don't want to jump in when I shouldn't, but I think it's important to protect your assets. I think it's always important to review any of your assets that have a beneficiary designation. I know that we have some on this call who've been very good about doing that, but just like the scenario that you presented, her late husband did not update the beneficiary on his IRA. So then you have a piece of your estate going through probate when you could actually avoid that if you pay attention to a life insurance or an annuity or anything else that would have a beneficiary.
Exactly. And that's perfect segue into the next one, Gina, as far as the estate planning side. Pillar two, want to make sure definitely those assets that you have, you want to take a look at what makes up your estate plan. So a will or a trust, I think the statistic is 60% of Americans out there don't even have a will. Well, actually they do, because if you pass away without any type of estate plan, will or trust, the state that you reside in or the state where your assets are held will make one up for you, and it'll follow through the state statute. So it just basically defaults to the state's planning. And every state is different. There is a hierarchy of beneficiaries where your assets will go to, and that may be completely different from what your intent is and what your wishes are. So if you live in Arizona and you have assets here and you die without a will or a trust, Arizona will dictate those assets. Perhaps you have real estate in Illinois or some other state, and you pass away. Well, that state will dictate that process through their probate. So it can get really, really sticky. But a will will move your assets from point A to point B, but there's a probate process, and that can take time. And depending on the complexity of your assets, it could take longer than you wish. As far as the beneficiaries getting those assets, there is quite a process to that. There's cost involved with probate costs, and could be some other fees. Probate is a public process. So a lot of us, we're very private. We want to make sure our business is our business, and we don't want anybody else to see what we've got. Probate doesn't protect you from that. Anyone can go down to the courthouse and find out what's going on in your estate and who's to get what. So there's no privacy. And the other thing, the will only takes effect upon your passing. And unfortunately, we don't always have, we don't always just pass away. There may be a period where we're unable to take care of things for ourselves. And if you don't have your POA in place for financial and health, then you may have what you call a living probate, a conservatorship, which again, the court dictates. So a will is one avenue as far as how to get your assets passed out. A trust would be the another way. It's the same way that getting your assets from point A to point B, but there's protection during life where you would be your own trustee. You would name a successor trustee. So if something were to happen to myself, temporarily even, I have a successor trustee that could step in immediately and have full authority over the assets that are in that trust. And as long as I title my accounts appropriately and I put my assets in that trust, everything should be seamless and my objectives will be taken care of. Power of attorney for financial. So that gives someone the ability to take control of those assets that may be in my name only. It could be an individual checking account or my vehicles or my home if it's in my name only. Power of attorney over health, same situation. Living will, that basically dictates your healthcare wishes if you're unable to dictate that. And then going back to the titling, Gina, your IRA, your annuities, life insurance, those are all contracts where they have a beneficiary designated. And that's where you want to be sure that you title those beneficiaries appropriately based on your estate objectives. Could be some going to charity. Perhaps it goes into your trust and it stays in trust for a period of time for your beneficiaries, or you name individuals where it goes outright. So going back to that scenario with mother, yes, she should have updated that IRA when her husband passed and had her kids named as 50-50 beneficiaries to equalize things. So that it's important to have these documents put in place and consider what's the right fit for you. Trust may not be the right fit. A will may be perfectly fine, as well as titling accounts with payable upon death. You just want to make sure that you're protected. Most importantly, that you are protected and your family's protected if you are no longer able to take care of things. And that's where you want to have some of these documents structured. So we'll go in a little bit more detail here as far as what types of assets and how they're titled get passed out. We talked a little bit earlier, but contract, your IRAs, your annuities, your life insurance, checking accounts with the payable on death designation, those are all by contract. You've named a designated beneficiary. So if I passed away, my wife would be named as the primary beneficiary. All she has to do is provide a copy of my death certificate and proof of who she is, and she gets that asset directly. It avoids probate altogether. Perhaps I forget to put an asset in the name, in joint name or have payable upon death, and it's in my individual name, and I pass away. Well, it would go through probate, and we talked about that process. Each state has a different way of doing things, but all of the accounts that I am the sole owner of or assets I'm the sole owner of would go through that process and then eventually go on to my beneficiaries that I've designated in my will. Or if I don't have a will, again, the state will decide based on its hierarchy who gets what. And then titling of your accounts. We talked about joint tenants of the right of survivorship, going back to mom and having her eldest son as the joint owner. If she passed away, that son now is 100% the owner, the surviving owner. So they now have full control and title of that account. And then lastly, if we establish a trust, if a trust owns that asset, that entity, now everything's under that bucket. The trust dictates what happens to that asset. If I have a trust upon my incapacitation or upon my passing, there's the trustee that's behind me, my successor trustee, has the ability to oversee and manage those assets, take care of me and me financially if I'm unable to do so, and then eventually pass those on to the designated beneficiaries that I've named. So it avoids probate altogether. So I want to give you a war story that I experienced. This is actually when I first got into the business. This was a interesting one that I had to deal with. I came in after the fact, but mom had three adult children. At the time, she was in her early 80s, and she her mental capacity was failing, but she was very physically, she's very healthy. So she moved into a assisted living facility. Her son, who lived in Illinois, was the sole successor trustee. So when mom was declared incapacitated, he moved up into that role. And now he, as the trustee, was completely responsible and liable for all of the assets in the trust and making sure that those assets were performing appropriately, taking care of mom's financial affairs, paying her bills, and just being a good steward of those trust assets. He had two sisters. Both of them lived in Arizona here, and her trust estate was a little over $2 million in assets at the time. And in her trust, she basically kept it very simple, wanted to leave everything to the three children. The scenario here was, you know, you not only wanted to, you know, mom had full faith in her son to take care of things, but really need to look out a little bit further and look at the spouses of the children. They're all married. And the story goes, they were all getting together and kind of reviewing the trust together. You know, mom's taking care of the assisted living, and they reading the trust, they realized they're all going to receive it equally in the end. So, you know, there's plenty there. Perhaps mom wouldn't mind if we took a little early inheritance and we, you know, take care of a few things. One wanted to, you know, build out the house, and the other one wanted to put in a pool, and the other one wanted to buy a new sports car. So they dibbled a little bit into that. Meanwhile, mom's, you know, again, in the assisted living facility, but over a period of time, they started nibbling away more and more at that, taking a little bit more early inheritance. And it got to the point where the trust was getting down to a level where there was some concern, because mom, being in her 80s, she still could live another 10, 15 years, and concern there that maybe the assets that were left weren't going to be there to take care of things. So unfortunately, became a lot of finger pointing, and the end result was all these kids each had their own attorney, and just more assets were dwindled through fees and cost. And that's where a corporate fiduciary came in. That's where I came in, where the court found that, you know, the son was unfit, and a corporate fiduciary really needed to be put in place to take on the responsibility and take care of mom. So it was a sad situation where, you know, a family that got together really well, and they didn't see any harm in their process, but in the very end, became a lot of friction and some stress on the trust assets to take care of mom. And this is an extreme situation, not to say that this happens a lot, but it can. Sometimes that green-eyed monster comes out there, and you know, you may appoint someone who has the best intentions, but you know, we're all human. Pressures in life, or you know, we have good days and bad days as individuals, and one little mishap or decision making can really skew the whole plan and kind of put it in tailspin. So it's important to, in this case, mom should have probably sat down with her kids ahead of time and really discussed what her intentions were for this trust and what her objectives are. And more importantly, explain to her son what his role and responsibility would be as a trustee. So a lot of things could have been taken care of ahead of time. So some points, sticking with the estate plan, to kind of consider, just to kind of recap, you know, with the FDIC accounts, if we've got things all spread around, sometimes it makes more sense to consolidate assets. You know, we can make sure we have things titled properly to fit under the FDIC rules if we're in the banking or if it's on an investment side of things. The ownership structure, you don't want to have, as it says, I have so many eggs and so many baskets, it's like herding cats. Well, it can be. it can be a very time-consuming process if you have multiple statements and accounts all over. So consolidation could be a real helpful process to take place. Your documents, again, depending on your estate plan, be it a will or a trust, or if you've got power of attorney designations, make sure all of that is buttoned up and you're planning ahead of time. If something were to happen to you and you weren't unable to take care of things, you've got the people that you want in place. Because if you don't, you may have a lot of friends coming out of the woodwork and wanting to kind of help. And then make sure your beneficiaries are documented correctly. Going back to beneficiary designations, your IRAs and annuities, make sure you've got everything buttoned up and the I's dotted and T's crossed on that as far as who is to get what. And it, again, conforms with what your wishes are. Because if you don't, it could create a whole other way, and would have to go through, could go through probate or some other type of process that really you wouldn't want to have done. And then more importantly, like I said, again, with the situation with the eldest son, whomever you name in that role, the personal representative or successor trustee, if that's the case, or just simply a joint owner of your account, make sure they understand what those duties and responsibilities are and the liability that goes into that. It is a full-time job. And a lot of times in my world, we kind of come in after the fact, where perhaps a family member or another individual is serving in that type of capacity, and they just don't have the time and the knowledge to take on that role. So again, one little hiccup can really skew things. This is just one page. I've got three other pages of all the different duties that go into serving as a trustee or a personal representative. And there's a tremendous responsibility that goes under that, into that duty. So again, being vocal with whomever you appoint, make sure they want to be in that role. After discussing their responsibilities, they may decide that, you know, perhaps it's not the best fit, or maybe you have a co type of trustee or executor type of situation where two or more can work together. Insurance would be the other pillar. And again, I'm not an insurance agent. I don't sell insurance, but I've had enough experience with clients and part of reviewing their wealth plan. Insurance is a piece of that, being life insurance, health insurance, obviously making sure that you've got full coverage on that. Long-term care protection is another piece in case you're no longer able to do things for yourself and you want to be sure you're protected. Life insurance, I'll kind of spend a little more time on that. That's a tool, and an important tool that can be utilized for wealth preservation. Right now, we're all given over 11 million in federal estate tax exemption. With the current discussions, the administration's plan, they like to bring that down. And if nothing happens, it will go down in 2026. It'll come back down to around 6 million. Could be lower than that. But when we add up our retirement accounts and real estate and other types of interest, some folks can get to that level pretty quickly. So life insurance could be a way of replenishing perhaps any estate tax or any other types of costs to your estate administration, replenish those to go back to your beneficiaries and make them whole. So life insurance can be an important component, and it's changed quite a bit in the industry. I had a situation with just recently with a client. She's in her late 70s, almost 80. And she, when her husband passed away, she had three kids. Her son received the business. So he received the business asset. And she wanted to make sure that she equalized things for her other two children. So life insurance was a way of doing that. And she took out a whole life policy to basically the death benefit would equalize things to each of them. And at the time, her understanding was that she would just need to pay premium for a certain period of years, and it would build up a cash value within that policy. And then from there, she wouldn't really have to worry about it because the dividends and the interest earned would be able to take care of that policy going forward. Well, the environment changed. Interest rates went down to nearly zero, as we all know. It's very, very low. And that policy wasn't able to cover that premium, that annual premium. So within that whole life policy, it took out loans. And when it takes out loans, that will diminish the death benefit when that time comes. When mom passes away, any loans outstanding within that will get paid off first, and then the net amount of the death benefit would go to the kids. So looking at the policy, it wasn't going to survive, and it wasn't going to do what her intent was. But as I mentioned, it's amazing, and this, the industry has changed so much. There's a lot of things that can be, a lot of options that can be done. In this case, she was in good health, even though she's in late 70s, she still had some cash value in there. And she was able to exchange that life insurance policy and really maintain the death benefit for no premium. In some cases, some clients can increase their death benefit for the same premium or less. So there's a lot of other things that could be done. So if you have a life insurance policy and it's something that you should review annually, it should be part of the process, just like your estate plan and reviewing your accounts, make sure that that policy is performing the way it should and there's no surprises. And if there's a gap in that piece, you definitely could probably take a look and do something even better given the changes in the industry. So insurance is another pillar that is important to consider.
Hey, Michael.
Yes.
I believe we have a question. Gracie, did you have a question for Michael? Oops, you're muted, Gracie. Can we unmute Gracie? Gracie, can you unmute yourself? It's not unmuting. There you go. Now you're unmuted, Gracie.
In the scenario where the lady was in assisted living,
yes.
Why was her son named as the sole trustee? Was it because she was mentally incompetent, or I mean, could she not have remained the trustee herself with him as the co-trustee?
Right. And if I had explained that, Grace, I apologize. Yes. So he was the sole. So during her life, she's the trustee. So you're right. During her life, and she's able to handle things, she's in full control. Nothing changes. She dictates the handling of that relationship. But in that scenario, if she became incapacitated, then her son would step in at that point in time. And then in that scenario, the deposit account, one of the deposit accounts was named in the trust. So he would be the successor trustee stepping in. He now would be completely responsible and liable for that asset going forward. But you're right. If she, during her life, if she's in because she's capacitated, she's in full control, nothing changes. She's still writing checks and doing what she does.
So yeah, because I thought there was definitely a difference between the mental capacity and assisted living. You know, you could still have your mental faculties and be in assisted living.
Yes.
But it wasn't just because she was in assisted living.
Well, correct. And I should have clarified that, right? She was declared incapacitated. Yeah, but great, great point. Thanks for catching me on that. The fourth pillar we have is investment. So the investment principles. So investing, budgeting is a part of that. Again, understanding what assets are made up under your wealth plan, what type of risk you may be taking, depending on the type of asset that you own, how your portfolio, if it's a traditional investment portfolio, how that's allocated. and then have a plan. And that's where your advisor, if you use an advisor, comes in to really kind of use them a resource, bounce off ideas, and kind of help them hold you to that plan. So on the budgeting side, retirement planning, you know, you want to look at all the different types of income resources that you have. Could be obviously Social Security, you have your IRA distributions, pensions, annuities. You may have a taxable investment account that's kicking out income. Understand, are those, is that income supporting your expenses? And what do those expenses look like year to year? We may want to take cruises or buy a new toy or gift to charity or children. So all those variables come into play, and you want to make sure that your income sources are performing. On the investment side, the risk return. You want to set your parameters as far as the expected return for your level of risk in your portfolio. Again, all different asset classes have different types of risk. Cash is probably the safest investment, right, as far as the risk spectrum. But there is inflation risk with cash, just holding cash. It may not keep up with inflation as we're seeing in the environment we're in today. Bonds, fixed income, they have interest rate risk. We're in a very low interest rate environment. If rates go up and you've got an old bond at a lower rate, they may lose value if you try to sell it. And then stocks, there's the market risk involved with that. So all those components go into the process as far as managing your risk versus your return. And then tax planning is an important component as well. And that goes back to your income sources and the types of accounts that you're receiving that income from. They may have different types of tax treatment. So those all come into play. Investment principles is a little bit busy slide here, but this is an investment quilt. You may have seen this before. Each asset class in here is a colored square. And this goes back the last 20 years. And I hope everyone can see this clearly, but it goes back 20 years. And there's the large cap US stocks in there. There's US fixed income, cash, real estate. They're each a different square. And what this really shows you is not one asset class consistently performs on top. Take 2017, for example, emerging markets. That was the best performing asset class. Well, the following year, it was the worst performing. And I think we, as investors, we can get very emotional in the process and start chasing performance. And that's where you can get yourself into trouble. And it goes back to that plan. I like the analogy I use is a few years back when my kids were younger, we decided to take the family truckster and go to Disneyland. And if you've ever been in that LA traffic, it's horrific. And I'm sitting there in traffic, four lanes, and my wife, she's a fantastic navigator. She kept encouraging me, well, get in this lane. It's moving. Our lane's not moving. Get into the lat lane. So I, of course, get into that lane. And what would happen? That lane would stop and the lane I was just in would go. Well, it's kind of like asset allocation and portfolio diversification. You don't want to chase that performance. You have a plan and you stay disciplined to that. And I would like to revert back to this quilt because it really does tell a story as far as, you know, over the years, not one asset class is consistently outperformed. So it's important to stick with your plan and don't necessarily get caught up in chasing that performance. This other screen, I'll just quickly, another way of showing, you know, staying with your plan. This is the S&P 500 Total Return Index. It's just an example, again, going back 20 years, the various events that we've experienced over that period of time. And, you know, had someone had 10,000 in the market at that time in the S&P 500, you could see that there's some volatility there. We had the global crisis and the housing bubble in 2008. And a lot of us, you know, we felt that. That was painful. And many of us got completely out of the market. However, if we had stuck to our guns and stayed in, we would have recovered that and then some. And as you can see, it doesn't all go linear in a straight line, but over time, if we stick to our plan and we stay disciplined, it typically will go up over time. I know that Gina has an expert coming up on identity protection, but it is an important one. There's not a week that goes by here at our firm that we don't have a client come to us concerned that they perhaps were a victim of identity theft. And it happens every day. And these criminals are getting bolder and more creative in how they do things. And I just wanted to point out a few things that we've experienced and some things that you may want to consider. And it's an unfortunate part of life, but it is out there and it is rampant. So CNBC had an article earlier this year that talked about identity theft, and the cost just in the US alone last year was $56 billion. Tremendous amount of money and loss for folks. So it's important to understand some of the more common identity theft scams. And again, it seems that they're always getting more creative in the way they do things, but we can put some things in place to protect ourselves and some measures. So some of the common identity theft methods, phishing scams, see this all the time, you know, online scams, people, criminals getting onto your email, they're able to hack into your email. They're trying to scam you through texts. And if you're online through advertising, you try to get you to click and get access to your computer. Phone scams, we see that every day. I had a client not too long ago. She had a call out of the blue. And it was a gentleman who very polite, but said they were with the IRS and that she owed X amount in back taxes. And of course that immediately got her upset and confused as to why. She thought she had everything taken care of. And of course he had said, well, you know, I see that I have on my record a couple of folks that have the common name. Could you give me your social security number so I can verify? Well, she should have known better at that time not to do that. And she unfortunately gave that individual her social security number. And of course, they told her, we're sorry that I had the wrong person. Well, she immediately thought twice, called me. She had a caller identity and that. We called the phone number and it was disconnected. So she was... It was someone scamming her to get whatever personal information they could. And so we had to put protections in place on her accounts, alert some of the credit agencies as to that. But that happens quite often where these individuals are getting better and better at their process. Medical identity theft, we see that where they're pretending to be from insurance companies, doctor's offices, even banks. A few years back, I had a client who had a relationship with a very large institution, and this criminal had actually hacked into the person's email. So they were able over time to collect data, understand maiden name of their mother, and social security information and addresses. They were able to collect that and find out where they banked, and they were able to somehow access the online banking component of their finances. And they actually called this individual impersonating as a banker and explained that there were some concerns with the account and that they would need to verify a few things. And of course, while they're on the phone, they're online on the bank account. The client didn't know that, but they're on their online, the client's online bank account, and they do a push for a PIN. Well, the PIN number goes to the client's cell phone number, because that's what the bank has, right? They have the account, the phone number for where to send information, and ask that client to provide the PIN number that was just pushed. When they gave them that PIN number, it gave that criminal the access to that account. And unfortunately, they were able to move some money from that account immediately. And it's a shame, but that that does happen. So we need to be very careful with any types of phone calls or any types of emails that we may get from people we may know or entrust. Nothing says we can't just pick up the phone to verify that's what they're asking. You know, we have their phone number, give them a call, understand or just verify that they are requesting the information that they want. I got a text just a day or two ago out of the blue from Chase Bank. I don't have a Chase relationship, but I noticed in the text it was a capital CH and lowercase ASE. And I called Chase, and they confirmed I don't have any accounts, but this text asked me to click onto a link. Well, if I had done that, probably would have gave them access to my phone or whomever, you know, whatever. They could get all my records. So just need to be very cognizant of those little things. So protective measures, private documents and passwords. A lot of this is common sense. You know, we want to protect our assets, shred any documents or mail that has your personal information on it. Just be on top of that. If you have bank relationships, a lot of times you could just take your old documents, and they have large shredder bins, and they've got shred companies that come in on a weekly basis. They can do that for you. Create unique passwords for each online account. Don't set the same password for each of your accounts. That's an easy one for these guys. There is an app. I don't know if most of you use apps, but there is it's an app called LastPass that I use because I can't remember everything, but it's a secure app that allows you to put on there your passwords for your different accounts. So if you do forget, you have the ability to retrieve that. And then, you know, friends or family. If you have someone that's a trusted member of your family or a friend, you could provide them access or give them information on how to access some of your personal accounts in case of emergency. Wi-Fi, social media. You go to Starbucks or any of these coffee places, make sure you don't look up your accounts in public networks. That's an easy one for them to access. Limit your information on social media profiles. And then the other one, if you can avoid it, try to use some alternative form of identification. Don't use your social security number. See if there's some other way you can set up with the institution that verifies who you are. And then review your accounts. Even the good guys make mistakes. Banks, investment firms, sit down with your advisor, go through your accounts, you know, transactions, mistakes or fee mistakes. It all adds up, and it's another way of protecting your assets. So sit down with your advisor and just review those types of accounts and transactions. And then of course, a bank safe or a safe deposit box is important documents to have and lock up. And lastly, I know we're kind of running into it, health management. I think that's a very important piece that we all need to consider. There was a quote, anonymous quote I read, I loved it. So many spend their health gaining wealth and then have to spend their wealth to regain their health. It's so important. Health is such an important part of your finances and your overall wealth. Taking care of yourself, not only physically, but cognitively, will obviously diminish the cost of your health care and prolong your assets. The US spent more than any other high income country in healthcare. We all know our healthcare costs. The next country in line was Switzerland, and we spent 42% more per capita on healthcare. So you know, take care of yourself. Exercise improves your mood and sleep. Obviously, it reduces your stress and anxiety, which allows you to make the right decisions for your wealth management and estate plan decisions. And then schedule your regular screenings. Your physician, your medical provider should be part of your team. You know, you've got your health and wealth team. You've got your attorney and your accountant and your advisors. Well, your doctors and your medical professionals should be a part of that. And take advantage of some of these resources that are out there. I mean, Sun Health Wellness, I get on their website every once in a while. It's incredible all the different types of classes and topics that are offered through the Sun Health Wellness, from chair yoga to nutrition. It's such a great resource, and you're all lucky to have that. So take advantage of that. You know, my grandmother, she lived to be 104, and she was sharp as could be to the end. And she played, she did crosswords every day and Sudoku, and we would get online and do Scrabble periodically. So she kept herself sharp, which again, was not only good for her health, but it was good for her wealth also. It kept things in order. So those are, I went through those last few quickly, but I know I'm up against it. Those are some of the six pillars that I think we all should take under consideration. There's certainly others, but as far as the experiences that I've had, I think those are important to consider. And it's not a difficult process to go through, but again, we're toward the end of the year. I think you should set back, review your situation, your estate plan, your assets, how the ownership structure is, the types of accounts. Make sure everything's buttoned up, because it is an ongoing process. But if you get everything taken care of, it's going to give you peace of mind and time to enjoy all the other things in life. So with that, I'll close, and I'll open it up to any other questions that you might have. And again, I just want to thank you again, Gina, for the invitation, and thank you all for the opportunity to speak and provide a little bit of my knowledge. So thank you.
Hey, Michael, great presentation. My goodness, you provided so many great points. If we took, I took notes on it here. And so I know that your office is in Scottsdale, but you make house calls, right?
Yes. Yeah, we are not everywhere, that's for sure. So we go to our client. They don't have to come to them, but we're a resource. You know, I encourage you to meet with your advisors, but if there's a question or two you might have, we're happy to do what we can to answer that for you. So welcome that.
So any questions for Michael? I know that we ran a little bit over. I want to be respectful of your time. So Yuta, do you have a question? No. Okay. Thank you. Michael, thank you so very, very much for all of this. And I love that you mentioned our wellness classes. You know, we, in addition to Sun Health Foundation Coffee with Gina and Friends, we also have wellness information as well. So you've done a great job. You know, Michael and I have spent a lot of time talking about wellness, and he just did a great overview of the team that can help you with that. Your medical team, your professional team, you're getting all of your things in order, and that eases the stress when things are tidied up and in order and makes things a lot healthier. So again, thank you for that. I think that you made some great points on this. And so we also hope that as you're taking a look at your wealth and your assets and your plans, that you might consider philanthropy in some of those plans. We're very pleased that the Generosity for Generations campaign, thanks to this community, we are at 71% of that goal, which supports the Sun Health Wellness programs, and then also projects over at Boswell and Webb. So we're very pleased about all that. As you know, Sun Health started more than 50 years ago with people just like on this call today who really made it possible to support the wonderful healthcare opportunities and education opportunities that are available to all of us just by a simple click or a simple phone call. So we are a trusted resource for you. You know, if you have a question or you need to know who's a good doctor, who's a trusted professional advisor, please reach in to us, and we are happy to provide you with contacts and names of people who we trust, who we would recommend even to our own family. So we want to continue to be that resource for you. We have a couple of upcoming events. We have our Heroes with Heart Gala, where we will be honoring a few physicians and the nursing profession as heroes with heart in our community, November 6th at the Renaissance Glendale Hotel and Spa in Glendale. And the proceeds from this event will support the expansion of the Banner Basel Medical Center. So that's been a very impressive project. And there's the contact information on the screen there. If you have not yet purchased your tickets, we encourage you to do so. Again, I encourage you to take a look at our wellness, Sun Health Wellness website also for wonderful classes there. A little bit different from our classes here, and they speak more to diabetes protection and diabetes management, fall prevention, those kinds of things. But we do have Dave Eastman coming up on November the 18th talking about your IRAs. You know, there are some challenges with individual retirement accounts right now in terms of beneficiaries. If your children are going to be the beneficiary of your IRA, there is a tax implication for your kids. The non-spouse beneficiaries could have a tax issue. Dave does a great job in talking about that. On December the 15th, Sharon Lind, our very own CEO of Banner Basel and Banner Del Webb, and she's also on the SunHealth Board of Trustees, she will be dialing in to talk about what's new at your community hospitals. That will be very, very exciting because there are some really wonderful things on the horizon in healthcare, and she is right on top of all that. And then January 20th, Tony Yee is the SunHealth Chief Technology and Innovation Officer. He will be talking about protecting your identity. You heard Michael address some of that. Tony comes with tremendous background in cybersecurity. And, you know, he's always on us to be careful about certain things. Great reminders, great points that Tony can make. I also want to thank Tony for dialing in today. And Sharon Graba, who is our Chief Financial Officer, she dialed in as well. So we will be finalizing our copies with Gina and friends for the next several months. So look for those information. And thank you, I want to reach out to Lou Lancaster. Michael, he's a fellow board of trustee, as is Shirley Frizzell, and they are on the call today too, supporting what you wanted to share with everybody. So if you have suggestions on topics you would like to see on Coffees with Gina and Friends, I think several of you talked about you want something around neuropathy, and that's been a big request from the group. So we'll be looking into that and a few other things as well. So feel free to keep those suggestions coming. We love to hear from you. We really are pleased that you continue to dial in, and we are also pleased that we have these wonderful professionals who share their wisdom in these environments as well. So with that, I will just like to close off and say, please continue to stay well, please continue to stay safe, and please continue to stay connected. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you in November. Bye-bye.